It's nearly 25 years since the invention of the laser. A beam of pure light that packs a punch. The fictional appeal of powerful beams of light as weapons is undeniable, but lasers have already made their mark on real battlefields in weapons guidance systems. Remember this from Brian Hanrahan.
From the mountaintop, the forward air observer was directing the Harriers in bombing runs against the Argentine defenders.
Roger, a bit plus of where we were aiming.
His position, peering over the top of the mountain, gave us our first view of Port Stanley.
Okay, bomb's gone. Where's the bomb? Got it? Okay, switch on.
As he talked to the pilots, he guided them in with a laser indicator, which can place the bombs precisely on target.
Where was that? I can now confirm that the bomb actually landed on the mark. Over.
Weapons that home in on a target that's been picked out by a laser beam. But what is a laser? The word stands for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. It's a very special kind of light. In a light bulb, the atoms of the filament are heated to an excited state. When the atoms drop back to their original state, they give off light, but it's very random. Light waves of different frequencies and all out of step. Inside this laser, the atoms of a gas are pumped up to an excited state, but the release of the energy is controlled in such a way that the atoms all release their light energy in step with one another. The beam that emerges is pure light waves of a single frequency, like a tuning fork. And it's this pureness that gives the laser beam its intensity. You don't have to use a gas to make a laser. Solids and liquids can be made to laze too. And laser beams have different colors and properties depending on the lasing material. So what exactly can you do with lasers? Apart, that is, from making pretty patterns. Well, if you put a laser on a rifle, because light travels in a straight line and laser beams don't spread out, your enemy's literally a marked man. The bullet is guaranteed to strike the spot of laser light. And because a laser beam is so pure, you can use it like a radar to measure the movement of distant objects from the patterns in the light that's reflected back to you. You can't actually see this laser beam because it's in the infrared, but it's there all right. It's produced by a carbon dioxide laser, which is mounted in the nose of this aircraft. The laser is there to measure wind shear, dangerous crosswinds that can prove disastrous if you come across them unexpectedly when you're landing. In flight, the laser beam is reflected back off minute dust particles in the air 300 meters in front of the plane. From the reflected radiation, the speed of the air ahead can be computed and displayed in the cockpit. If there's wind shear ahead, there's plenty of time to abort the landing. The detection of scattered laser light is also the secret of the laser's success in the battlefield. The man on the ground pinpoints the target with his laser beam. Sensors on the aircraft, or on the weapon, home in on the scattered spot of laser light. Yes, just like those laser-guided bombs that proved too much for the Argentinians, there's a whole arsenal of laser-guided missiles available from your friendly local arms dealer.
In coordination with either an airborne or a ground designator, the attack pilot has no requirement to visually acquire the target. This is the laser spot as seen by Silicon Vidicon camera. The actual spot is invisible to the unaided eye. The Laser Maverick has unique advantages for close air support. These include positive target identification, non-centroid aim points, reduced air-to-ground communications, and after-launch breakaway to improve survivability.
The laser's latest contribution to mankind? Apparently a weapon to blind enemy soldiers. Yet, ironically, one of the greatest successes of the laser has been in curing blindness. Diabetes is the main cause of blindness in middle age. It affects the retina, the part of the eye which transmits visual messages to the brain, by weakening the retinal blood vessels so that they leak and interfere with vision. And more serious damage is caused by the growth of new blood vessels. The cure? A laser of a frequency that affects some tissues and leaves others untouched.
So now just pop some drops in your eyes. Look out for them. Your chin,
all
the rest, and your forehead against the bar.
That's it. Just look down a tiny bit.
The laser that's used is an argon laser. An ordinary light beam is used to aim, then the laser is fired. Its blue-green light is preferentially absorbed by its complementary color, red. So the tiny red blood vessels absorb the energy. Damaged blood vessels are cauterized. New blood vessels are destroyed. It can also spot weld a detached retina back into place. The same principle can be applied to treating port wine stains, deep red marks on the face or neck. The blue-green beam passes through the normal epidermis without being absorbed, but the network of capillaries that forms the stain absorbs the heat and is destroyed. After several treatments, you're left with a colorless scar. Tattoos, on the other hand, are self-inflicted. Nowadays, you can use our friendly laser to wipe the slate clean.
Now, Mrs. Acklin, yes. With all that local anaesthetic, you wouldn't feel anything, but you let me know if it's not at all comfortable.
All right.
The patient is given a local anaesthetic, so the operation to remove the tattoo is painless. The laser burns the outer layers of skin and vaporizes the pigment underneath. Eventually, the skin closes up, leaving hardly a mark. A simple outline can be removed in one treatment, but one that's shaded in may take more.
I wouldn't like to say for certain, but I think it'll be just...
possibly.
Certainly two, possibly three.
Yeah.
A laser can also be used as a high-precision, bloodless scalpel. This tongue tumor is being removed by a carbon dioxide laser which seals small blood vessels instantly. Its infrared radiation is absorbed by water in the tissues, and the cells simply vaporize. Because the tissues conduct heat poorly, there's almost no damage to the adjoining area, so healing is fast. Some conditions were simply untreatable before the laser. In a confined space like your larynx, the surgeon just can't see what he's doing if there's blood everywhere. A child's larynx is only a few millimeters wide, and conventional surgical instruments make it even harder to see what's going on. The laser removes tumors without the risk of swelling, which might block the airway. But let's take a deeper look.
I'm just going to slip the tube over the back of your tongue, Mr. Hall. That's fine.
This is a gastroscope. It's a bundle of glass fibers which lets a surgeon look right into a patient's stomach.
This is certainly a duodenal ulcer and it's bleeding. So could I have the laser fiber, please?
Then he feeds a special optical fiber connected to a laser down the gastroscope. The laser light travels down the fiber just like water down a pipe, and the surgeon can direct the beam onto the ulcer to cauterize the bleeding point. But perhaps the most exciting development using lasers and fiber optics is the treatment of coronary heart disease. The laser vaporizes the fatty deposits that are blocking the arteries. It's rather like decoking a car engine. The technique is very new, but early trials have been very promising. And soon it may be performed without the need for open heart surgery. Feeding a laser fiber through to the heart from an opening in the patient's thigh or arm. Optical fibers are the key to communicating by laser light. These strands of glass that swallow up light can carry signals round corners and bends, just like electricity inside a copper wire, but much more efficiently. So from 1985, British Telecom will be laying optical cables rather than copper on all major routes. But the development of optical fibers is only half the story. To complete the technology of light communication, tiny laser chips had to be developed. Devices like these, pulsing hundreds of thousands of times a second, encode the messages that are sent down the fibers. It's like an ultra-fast signal lamp. A transatlantic optical cable, now being planned, could handle 40,000 simultaneous phone calls. And optical fibers will bring us cable TV, no doubt with a diet of non-stop pop videos and plenty of laser special effects. Already lasers give us TV from video discs. And there's the new compact audio disc, which was subjected to this early morning trial by Jam.
Well, let's give it the breakfast time test. Some honey, nice and sticky and lovely. Smear that over liberally. Make sure it's nicely spread around there. Bit of coffee. Should see it through. And give it a quick wipe down.
Instead of a needle, it's played by a laser reflecting off its surface.
Right, that should be it. Let's see how it sounds.
So it's immune to scratching and just about anything else. And also on a laser disc, there's the latest in video games.
Instead of quaint little computer-generated characters, there's full-blown, high-quality animation, controlled by the player. Make the right move, and the hero stops before the menacing bank of knives, executes a somersault, and escapes. But make the wrong move, and when the hero tries for his getaway, too late. Not only is the picture radically different, so is the sound, which is capable of very high fidelity, because neither picture nor sound is computer-generated. Rather, they are recorded on a high-technology laser beam version of a video disc player, using the same animation procedures that produced Mickey Mouse in Snow White. But these adventures are vastly more complicated, because every scene must have two or more alternative conclusions, each flowing pictorially from the preceding action. In this tunnel, the hero has the chance to escape through a hole in the wall, or to reach for that chain. If he misses, he slides to doom. On the other hand, if he does reach the chain, look out.
Whatever next? 3D TV? Not quite yet. This is a hologram. Or rather, this was a hologram. A three-dimensional picture recorded on a flat photographic plate by laser beams. And if you break it into tiny pieces, each fragment will still contain a whole image of the object. But each piece will give you a different point of view. This may look three-dimensional, but it's not. The image comes from a flat plate. The pattern made on the plate by the laser light contains all the information that's needed to reconstruct a 3D image of the object. Make a hologram that includes a magnifying glass, and the holographic magnifying glass behaves as though it was a real one.
Open wide, please.
If you've ever had treatment to straighten your teeth, you'll probably have had plaster molds made. They're used to check your progress. The problem is storage space. Hundreds of these molds are made each day, and medical law requires they all be kept for 8 years after the treatment is over. The laser is the solution. Just make a hologram of the mold. You can take measurements to see how much the teeth have moved just as accurately from the hologram as the real thing. Turn it over and you have a mold, like seeing it inside out. And you can take measurements of that as well. The hologram slips into a folder with the rest of the patient's records, and all those bulky plaster molds can bite the dust. But it's the power of the beam itself that you can really put to work. The laser can generate high temperatures, and it can deliver the energy precisely where it's needed for cutting, drilling, or welding metal. Because nothing touches the part that's being worked on, there are no vibrations and no saw blades or drill bits to blunt or break. Oh, and just in case you think lasers are the greatest thing since sliced bread, they aren't any good for slicing bread. Try it, and you'll end up with burnt toast. The laser's ability to generate high temperatures is being used to try and create energy by atomic fusion. That's the process that creates energy in the sun. Making it work on Earth means using the power of the laser to unlock the energy in atoms. The lasers used for these experiments are so huge, you have to fold them up to get them into any reasonable-sized building. It's all done with mirrors. Sending the beam through periscopes, round corners, and round more corners until you can get a straight run at the target chamber. There, the beam is aimed at tiny pellets of hydrogen fuel. It raises their temperature to 100 million degrees. For a trillionth of a second, they will burn like mini stars. So far, they're getting less energy out than they put in. The principle seems right. but we'll have to wait for a fusion power station.
Laser, coming on.
This is a carbon dioxide laser, one of the most powerful in the business. And this is a piece of titanium, one of the toughest metals. Ever since people got hold of this kind of high-energy laser, they've been trying to shoot things down with one. The difficult thing is to get enough energy into the target to zap it. A nice clear day, a slow-moving target only a few hundred meters away, and, conveniently, they painted it red to help absorb the laser's energy. A beam of light travels at 186,000 miles per second, so there's no need to shoot ahead of a moving target. Even a real aircraft flying at twice the speed of sound would move only an inch or so in the time the beam takes to reach it. But that was too easy. A less cooperative target would be fast and shiny. But the problem with these extremely powerful laser beams is that they spread out. The beam and its power is weakened. It's easy to demonstrate. Shine a laser across a wind tunnel and let the beam strike a firebrick. Increase the wind speed, and the beam gets brighter, more power. Reduce it, and the air has time to heat up as it passes through the beam. The result is that the heated air behaves like a lens, spreading the beam out. The obvious conclusion? Put your laser in a nice, fast stream of air. This is the US Airborne Laser Lab, a converted KC-135 aircraft which is a military version of a Boeing 707. About a third of it is taken up by an enormous 400 kilowatt carbon dioxide laser. The fuel for the laser is a mixture of carbon dioxide, helium, and nitrogen, pumped on board under pressure before each test. Last year, after assorted unsuccessful experiments, the Airborne Laser Lab successfully defeated a Sidewinder air-to-air missile for the first time. Despite this success, the air continues to present problems, not the least being turbulence around the plane itself. Now, the Russians are reported to have equipped one of their latest warships with a high-energy chemical laser, capable of destroying low-flying aircraft, sea-skimming missiles, and cruise missiles. When your target is at close range, the dispersing effects of the air are minimized. But there's one place where there's no air to cause a problem. Space. The Americans are considering testing a laser weapon on board this, the Space Shuttle. What they ultimately want to do is hit a target in space. There's plenty of superpower interest in using lasers as anti-satellite weapons. Satellites are essential as the electronic eyes and ears of the military, and they are relatively easy to kill. So, put lasers on board your satellites to knock out theirs. But there's a lot more to the story than that.
Let me share with you a vision of the future which offers hope. It is that we embark on a program to counter the awesome Soviet missile threat with measures that are defensive.
President Reagan's Star Wars project. Don't freeze nuclear weapons, zap them with lasers instead. One idea is satellite laser weapons, which could destroy Russian missiles in flight. With a layered system like this, there would be several chances to attack each missile. But what if just one or two missiles slip through? Well, it's argued, even a leaky system would generate enough uncertainty over the outcome to deter a Russian attack.
Let us turn to the very strengths in technology that spawned our great industrial base and that have given us the quality of life we enjoy today.
Even if you could build powerful enough lasers, there are many other problems. You'd need huge, optically perfect mirrors to focus a laser beam over the thousands of miles of space. This one's only half a meter in diameter. It's taken months to make, and you'd want one at least eight times this size. It's doubtful whether you could make a perfect mirror that large. The technology is getting better, but the problems of building precise mirrors that could survive the rigors of a space launch are huge. The next problem is power. You can't get enough electricity into space easily. The laser could be chemically powered, but even so, an enormous bulk of chemicals would have to be shuttled up for each operation. So try keeping the laser on Earth, on a mountaintop perhaps. Then you'd only need the mirrors in space to redirect the beam to the target. And the beam could be relayed to distant battle stations via several mirrors.
What if free people could live secure in the knowledge that their security did not rest upon the threat of instant U.S. retaliation to deter a Soviet attack, that we could intercept and destroy strategic ballistic missiles before they reached our own soil or that of our allies?
The problem with any system in orbit is that it's easy to knock out, so another idea is a pop-up system. It lives on the ground, and you only launch it when you need it. The pop-up system could be the orbiting mirrors for the mountaintop laser, or it could be this, an X-ray laser. Powered by a nuclear bomb, it would fire scores of lethal beams before being vaporized itself. Critics say a pop-up system would take too long to be operational, and that its launch could be misinterpreted as a first strike. Others say that any new weapons undermine the uneasy balance of terror.
I know this is a formidable technical task, one that may not be accomplished before the end of this century. Yet current technology has attained a level of sophistication where it's reasonable for us to begin this effort. Years, probably decades of effort on many fronts. There'll be failures and setbacks, just as there will be successes and breakthroughs. But isn't it worth every investment necessary to free the world from the threat of nuclear war? We know it is.
Copy, Harry.